Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us for another episode of Blue Blood on the Main Line. Today we have another Villanova legend with us, Ryan Archie Diacono. Many of you have known him from his years of obviously playing the point guard position at Nova. Some of us that are not traditional Nova fans know him with the Chicago Bulls, but most importantly, we know him as Mr. The Pass, which is arguably the greatest, in my opinion, the greatest shot in Final Four history. Ryan, thanks for joining us. We really appreciate you taking the time out, being busy this week with training camp. How you doing?
I'm doing well. I appreciate you having me. It's been a long, crazy road to get to where I am, and with COVID and everything, it's good and it's refreshing to be able to start training camp with a fresh mind, get back out on the court. But I'm excited to think back and talk about Villanova basketball, and I appreciate that very nice intro. But yeah, I'm excited to be here.
Thanks. You know what? Here's one thing that I always like. I like to always get different perspective to get, when I say behind the scenes, just stuff that people don't think about. That's why I like to uniquely focus on at times. Mm-hmm. So take us to, if you go back, take us to right before you got to Villanova. Like, why did you choose Nova? What was it about Villanova that made you want to come?
So growing up in Bucks County and Langhorne, I was a local kid. Both my parents had gone to Villanova, as I'm sure everyone has heard. But I grew up watching all those Big East Mondays, and Villanova was the team to watch. I mean, the first couple teams I truly remember were the days with you, with Nardi, with Randy, with A-Ray, with Kyle, just those teams. And it just progressed on to the Scotty Reynolds years, and then it moved on to like this Corey Stokes, Corey Fisher, and then like Malik in them. So I can go down the line of players that I just love watching. Reggie Redding, local guy, and then just kind of I knew that I wanted to be a Villanova basketball player. Now I got recruited by Florida a lot. It's actually my coach now, Billy Donovan, was recruiting me a ton at Florida, but I had two great schools to choose from. Coach Wright did a great job in the end, recruiting me and pitching me towards a great university and a great basketball program. So I definitely wanted to just be a part of it, having grew up watching so much and aspiring to be a Villanova basketball player.
That's nice. That's nice. And it's always just good to hear, you know, each player's individual mindset, like what went into it. Because I think what you're finding out and what I found out when I first – after I graduated, not too long after that, I graduated, it was 2 years later, I was playing with the Harlem Globetrotters when I was traveling, and then I ran in. And the thing is, being that I was a Globetrotter and then also a coach on NBA bench,
yeah,
you see the different, you see the traveling, you see how much goes into it, right?
Yes.
I kid you not, traveling with the Globetrotters was like traveling in NBA on steroids. We literally played 127 games in 124 days, never repeating the same city two days in a row.
That's crazy. I don't know how your body held up.
So here's the trade-off. It's you gotta, running is running. You have to run, you have to catch your dunks, you gotta do, you know, you're posting up if you're big, but it's not physically taxing in a sense where the guy's trying to beat you down. So you're not taking all the hard fouls, but you're still playing every night. And you actually go over the show. Let's say a game, we call it the show, but let's say a game is 2 hours or 2.5 hours. You literally go through the whole entire thing, 2.5 hours, get a 30-minute break, and then do it for real every day.
That's crazy.
Because you got to think about it. If you go into your first Globetrotter game, right, and you have your hard-earned money, you don't care. This is my seventh game in 6 days, or seventh game in 7 days. You came to see the Globetrotters, so we had to be on point that way. But the whole point of me saying that is, from traveling, I ran into former players. I ran into Randy a lot. Also ran into Coach Pinckney. And I remember talking to them on the road and seeing how it is, and then coaching on my side. And I saw them run into other players. And for me, it was, I think it was Craig Smith and Jared Dudley. Like, one saw the other, And they were like, hi. They were saying, hi, hey, what's up? But they were running mates when they were college. They were the two big dogs on the team. And what stood out to me when I saw multiple guys see players that they play with, it's different. Like, we didn't even play with each other. But if we saw each other, you know, like that joy that you feel, and it's like a true brotherhood.
Yeah.
I don't see that anywhere else. And yeah. Do you see that? And my question is, do you come across an NBA? Like, when you see someone from Villanova, do you see the difference between when you see a former player that you play with compared to when the other guys see their former teammates?
Yeah, I think there's a level of, everyone has a bond that they create at each of their schools. But I just think Villanova is just different because we literally do everything together and really care about each other besides the stuff on the court. And I think that really makes a difference. Anytime I see Dante, Jalen, Josh, whatever the case may be, even talking to Kyle, you know, it's not like I played with Kyle. It's not like we've had that much interaction besides a couple like summer jams playing against each other and stuff and admiring to be like him. But he still takes his time out. We still take our time out to ask how the family's doing. And then we have that bond together, that Villanova basketball, which is, I think it's just different. I think it's just so much different than filtering in players, because a lot of our guys are staying 3 to 4 years. Now, we've been fortunate recently to have some two and done. I know there was a couple one and duns or whatever the case may be, but I think that throughout that 3 to 4 years, and knowing that we all played for Coach Wright, and we know the grind that it takes to be able to play for a coach like him, because he's so demanding at 6 a.m. in the morning or 7, 8, 9 o'clock at night, whenever you're watching film or however long he has you in there, he's definitely demanding, and it's a level of respect that we all have for each other. So we always make sure we go out and see each other. But I definitely noticed that our relationship, meaning the Villanova basketball players, looks to be stronger than it is with other guys from other schools. It just doesn't feel the same because Coach Wright and the whole staff and the university does a great job of bringing us all back and making us feel as one, versus like your 06 team versus my 16 team. It's not like we're head to head like that. Yeah, we're competitive, but it's more like we all take pride in each other and feel a part. And that's what Coach Wright does a great job of, making you feel a part of all the teams that come after you. You know, like, I feel a part of every team that I felt that I won another national championship with the 18 team, just watching them because those are my guys I played with, and just everything about them. He just makes you feel that way. So I definitely think it's different because it's just a special, special place.
Hey, two things. It's one thing I didn't even realize, and I heard it when you were saying it. There is a level of consistency, being that we all play for the same coach, so that's a bond. But even bigger than that, it's almost like a badge of honor. Like you said, we went through that system, and we know what that means. We know the grind. Sure. We know the level of attention to detail that is mandated from us. Mm-hmm. And it's like, oh, you went through that? Okay, yeah. It's like we all wear the same badge of honor, if you will.
Absolutely. Playing for Coach Wright is a badge of honor in itself. Like, we'll look back and other players be like, oh, Coach is just being Coach. Man, what did Coach do that one time? Man, one time he did this to me and we had to do this. It's like we all have our own stories, which makes it great, and it creates that level of bond between each other in different classes and different age groups. And then just knowing that Coach Wright brought out the best of us, because 95 to 100% of the dudes that stay all 4 years and or stay in the program as long as they can before they leave for the draft or turn professional, they all become better men too, like mm-hmm. off the court as well. So I think he just does a great job. And we see it now later in life that he had to be as hard as he was, and he had to coach us a certain way to make sure that we were good enough then and to set us up for the future as well.
Right. You want to hear something funny? So coaching, you know how many times I find myself saying a line that Coach says, and I'm like, oh my gosh, I can't believe I just said that. Like, it's like,
or probably even happens all the time.
Oh man. Do you remember like being in practice and someone may look down and tie their sneakers something, and they, like, let's say if you just looked off to the side because you heard a sound at the entrance door, and he goes, Arch, ice. Ice.
Yeah. Too many times I was afraid to like not look that dude in the eyes from 94 feet away. He would know if you're looking like above, like at the basket. And he was that dude he's crazy, but hey, he brings out the best of us. And crazy, I mean, in a good way, you know,
yes.
like he had to do it. And then we were as good as we were. and you guys were as good as you were because you all eventually bought in and mm-hmm. and understood that it was bigger than just the individual success with him, and every little detail really made a difference.
Okay. And the other thing that you said when they won in, when we won in 2018, you felt like you won a national championship. And I remember when you, which obviously I'm going to ask you about, you spoke about, I'm sure, a million times.
Yeah,
you're
going to
be
sure.
asked 10 million more times about what went into your mindset when we ran Cats.
Yeah.
And you go down and you're dribbling. I'm going to ask you to take us into that. But my two cents before you go, that play, he first wrote up that play with our class. And that's what we ran.
Oh,
yeah,
really?
Cats, it didn't change. We knew what we were doing. It was Cats. And you knew what you would do, 8 seconds or below. And if we had, I think it was, if it was 3 seconds or below, it was the full court. It was the screen.
Yeah.
Up screen,
yeah. No, I remember the plays. I don't know if I remember the play calls. I feel like it was called like Nova.
Nova, right.
That was like the 4 to 7 seconds. There was something 7 to whatever. And then 3 or lower was with the Cats play where you throw it.
Cats, right. Cats was the Nova you ran.
Yeah.
Now, here's the thing. When you ran it, I'm looking and I felt like we were in the game. I felt like, you know, I was the big on the other end. And I felt like you were Kyle or Rainey driving and A-Ray or Rainey or vice versa, Court or Kurt. And it felt so good just because you said that you know that we all went through this. It's the same program, same coach. Take us through that. So take us through first the first shot that's made.
Yeah.
Then Carolina comes out, hits the three, and then you have to go into, Nova. Go ahead.
We had the lead. Josh made a couple free throws, 1-on-1, and then just a crazy play. We're trying not to give up a three, and for whatever reason, Daniel, I think he said that he thought that he could get a steal. The ball was right there. He wasn't as close on video as he was in person. Marcus makes a crazy double clutch shot to tie the ball game. And the first thing that went into my head, like right after that, wasn't like, I didn't think we were going to lose. The first thing in my head, cause I knew the play that we were about to run, was like, I'm going to make the best shot in college basketball history. Like, this is all writing for like me to make this shot. Not because like I'm going to demand the ball, but because I knew the ball was in my hands and I was mm-hmm. the decision maker. So there was a sense of calmness in that huddle because we all knew what was up. We didn't even need coach to draw up the play.
Right, right.
We sat there for like 15, 20 seconds, just like kind of looking at each other like after, because we all knew what to do. We'd practiced it every single day for 3 years, and we knew what was up. It was just a matter of, was I going to make the right decision? Daniel knew he was going to set the screen. Chris is inbound, and Josh was setting a pick for Phil. So – besides me thinking like I got to be aggressive and score this ball for the team, and I wanted it selfishly, I knew that I had to make the best decision for our team. And as I get the ball, I just knew that Daniel was setting a screen, and Chris told me, I heard like as I crossed the half court line, all I heard was like arch, arch, arch in front of 75, 79,000 people. And I just passed him the ball. And every time Chris shoots the ball, he has such pretty form that I always thought the ball was going to go in. And when I passed it there, it was no different. Just pure jubilation after he made the shot. And like for me to end my college career on assist, I felt it is the most like fitting way, selfishly being like, you know what, like I tried to do everything and what was best for the program on the court and off the court. And I felt that like me passing the ball to someone else and them getting the big glory and all that stuff was just like, it's awesome. I beam with pride of it. So I knew. It's just kind of crazy that we all know specifically like what the play was. Like you knew that, you're still thinking back because we did it so many times and it's ingrained in us. The other day when we were watching, or I just was walking by and I like Nova was playing, they ran the play with like 1 second left and you try to get the charge, and Justin actually got the charge and they called the foul. So I knew exactly what they're doing. Now for that play to actually work, you need a ref who's actually going to be able to have the balls to call it.
Yes.
Someone's going to be like, I'm going to make this call. And if not, I mean, hey, whatever, you chuck it down, see if you can get a quick shot off. But it's just, it's funny because when I was watching that against, I think it was Virginia Tech, when they lost, I still knew what they were trying to do. And I knew what was about to happen. I'm like, oh, did we get it? And then they called the foul. And I'm like, did he call it on us? Did he call it on them? And it's just funny because when you look back, you know exactly the plays, you know, the underneath out of bounds. Maybe you might not remember the names, but you definitely remember how many times you practiced it, and what is about to come.
And I think, and it's interesting how you said that, because you can know, like when I speak with players now, they'll say, "Coach, the other team knows." And I go, "Yeah, I know they know. But guess what? They're going to have to stop it. We have options. You know, we execute it." And like for example, back to the national championship game. Yeah, the other team probably knew you were driving. And they'll say, "Well, he's going to drive. And if we stop him, he's going to pass it back to – he's going to shuffle to Chris, or he's going to look to the wings." Mm-hmm. Or – you can take all that and play arch 101 going full tilt, and then he's going to drain a three anyway.
Yeah. So. No, it's crazy. I mean, I remember like coaches, I think it was like Buzz Williams or someone at Marquette, literally just like looked down at us and coaches calling the play, and we would just run the play anyway. And in timeouts, he'd be like, "I could give two, you know what's about them knowing the play. They could have our whole playbook. Let's go hand it to them. We're still going right. to execute and find a way." Like Coach Wright, like, find a way, let's out tough them, whatever the case may be. You can know our offense, you know our defense, but you're still not going to beat us because we do it better than what you do, respectively. Yeah. But I just remember that so many times you'd be like, I couldn't care less. You know, you take our plays and we'll still beat you.
Yeah. And I think, and unlike football, where it's debilitating, if you know exactly what play you're running at that time,
yeah.
It's just so beautiful seeing the evolution of Villanova basketball from its glory days, from winning '85 and then the great plays before then, to its, in the 90s, the early mid 90s, when Alvin Williams, Haynes, Jay Law, Kerry Kittles, Tim Thomas, then, you know, to the struggles to build back up, and in the Coach Wright era, it's just so beautiful to see things develop. Because even when he said, "I could care less," I remember we were playing, I think it was, I don't want to say the wrong team. We're at home, but I'm a Curtis. So Curtis Sumter comes to the bench. Mm-hmm. And he says, Coach is like, "Well, like, Coach was supposed to set like a pin screen," and he goes back door instead. And he goes, Coach goes, why did you cut to the rim? Why didn't you just set the screen?" He goes, "Coach, I think they know what we're running." And then the coach says, "I don't care what they think." And he says to Kurt, "Run the play and run it the right way. Look for," and he draws up, "look for option A, first option, second option, third option."
Yeah.
We score, we go on a little run, they call a timeout, and then Kurt Liddy goes, I don't forget, he looks at Coach and goes, "Coach, you were right." And Coach goes, "Oh, thank you. Yeah, I was right, thanks. Thanks, Curtis."
I feel like he had to have had, I can't remember specifics, but I'm sure he had his fair share of them with Javon. I mean, I'm not saying him and Curtis are the same, but like Javon would be like, "Coach, what are we doing?" And just they butted heads, but they definitely had their fair share of them too.
Well, and you know what it is? I remember when Coach was building everything, I said this before, even the stone cutter and everything else, it was in San Antonio. And he's watching San Antonio and he's watching the Spurs, and you see the similarities and the beauty of basketball being played the right way, right? Mm-hmm. So what I'm a firm believer is, I'm going to put my studs in positions where you have to compromise your defense to stop it. Mm-hmm. And if you stop it, my counter move, or AKA other option, is going to be, you have to leave one of my better shooters open, or a late contest, or you're going to have to help and have one of my great drivers or slashers cut into the basket. So you put the defense in a compromising situation. They can't stop everything. So that's the beauty in all of that. But so I want to move on to you now specifically. Let me say this. I know I speak for myself and I speak for all of Nova Nation, and I know you hear this a lot. I am beyond proud of you. I look forward towards your games. I was excited. Actually, my son was playing 2K on his iPad, and it said Archie Diacono, because he scored. And my wife was in the bed and she was like, "Wait, what?" And because she's thinking, you know, because it's the game and everything. Yeah. Like, "No, my son is just using his iPad." And I said, "That's funny. You're just playing with the Bulls." I said, "That's Ryan." And she said, "What?" And it's just because, you know what's cool? Like, you're a grown man now. But you got to remember, we see you guys when you were younger.
Yeah, I remember it. I remember, I mean, you would come, I'm just thinking back to when you would come and practice with us, like when you were working during my years. I can't remember specifics. And you were just sitting, we still were playing Syracuse, and you're just sitting there just in your 2-3 zone, just in the middle, getting every rebound, scoring on us and kicking our ass. We've definitely grown up. It's that's the, like the crazy thing. You get to see everyone in their development and their successes, whether it's on the courts playing professionally or off the court doing well in the business world. You get to see all these guys like Henry Lowe, you see Pat Fowle, Kev Raff, like I'm just naming my class.
Right.
And younger guys besides them too, you just see that. You just see the progression from like, oh, I remember when you were 18 and a freshman and I was 26 and now I'm 35 and you're out here on Wall Street working and being super successful. It's more than basketball at Villanova, which is awesome too. And you get to really take pride in everyone else's successes for sure.
Yeah. And man, yeah, just very proud of you. So look, I like you, I already know your worth ethic and I know what happens behind the scenes and it's hard to actually put it in words. You just got to know it and see, I already know it. So I was excited for the, so take us through, you with the Bulls, right? And then you had a break where you started getting big minutes, right? Yeah. And obviously you've been doing something right. Obviously you were doing well because you're still there, right?
Yeah.
And still you ain't going anywhere. And on as a side note, I like you know me with my personality, I would have saw Coach Donovan said, "I told you I would have played for you." You know, just not where you thought, not in Florida. I told you.
For sure. Eventually I would. But yeah, going back to like the minutes thing. So I was trying to make my way onto the team as a two-way player, stayed here all summer, worked my butt off and made them try to like kick me out of the gym. And then I just made the team from a non-guaranteed contract. And they were bringing in other guys to try to beat me out and stuff. And I just played better and played well. And just, I didn't try to be like, oh, I need to play better. It was just like play my game and trust it and go from there. And then I played well at the beginning of the season and I eventually got put in the starting lineup. And there was a time where I think I played 4 or 5 games in a row where I played over 38 minutes in an NBA game, which is just kind of crazy. We had some injuries, but I was playing well enough to garner and get in there. So it was a surreal moment. And you know what? It became my normal of like trying of like playing and being like, you know what? I have confidence. I can make an impact on an NBA team. And it just gave me more confidence moving forward. Even when the starters and everyone came back and my minutes got cut, I just was able to be like, you know what? Hey, I started at a point, I'm able to impact a game. It might not be every night, but you never know when your number is going to be called again. And just keeping that stay ready mentality instead of having to get ready. But that time was great. And I think that was a big break for me and my career and just taking advantage of opportunity. I think a lot of life and a lot of hoops and sports in general is just timing and opportunity. It's unfortunate injuries happen in the game. And if you're able to take advantage of it, you just can't look back and just trust yourself. So that's why you put in all that work, just being ready for that one chance. Cause that's, you never know, that might be the only chance you get to prove yourself. And fortunately for me, I was able to prove myself and I'm still sticking around here and I'm trying to stick around as long as I can.
So this week you have training camp, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Now transferring into your last statement, what is your advice? I'm in college, I'm wondering what it is to play in the NBA, or I just graduated college, I'm on a two-way contract, or I'm on the outside looking in, I'm overseas. Talk to them as the mindset, because you said a mouthful, you said multiple things, but I'm gonna let you explain it, where you talked about, you talked about working hard, making them having to kick out of the gym. You talked about being prepared. You talked about playing the right way, just not stop. You looked at it as not out beating someone else out, but knowing that there's a level of confidence. You knew you played ball the right way, that if you just played your game, that you'll prove your worth. Speak to them about, like, what's your mindset going into this training camp, given your history, and if you used to give them advice?
No, the same thing. I mean, going in for myself, going into this training camp, it's just play the game that I know how to play, and that's becoming a lot of the NBA is you got to be able to pass, dribble, and shoot, and move the ball, and try to have a high IQ and create good open looks for your team. Like analytically, can you get us a better shot or get us a good shot anytime you're out on the court? So I think that my game fits well to just be able to just go out there and just trust it. Because like you said, everyone works hard and puts that work in and does their sweat equity. And they really try to make themselves a better player. But for me, you just got to be able to go out there and just trust yourself. Just trust yourself. If you go out there, don't try to be anyone else. Don't try to do anything else that you don't know how to do just to make a team. And don't worry about if other teams are bringing or your team's bringing other guys in or they're recruiting over you or whatever the case may be. You'll always have a little bit of an upper hand because you've been there before and you've trusted your work. If you try to go out there and be someone else, it'll show because your game won't be the same. For me, it was like, you know what? I know I'm not the most athletic. I know I'm not the most knockdown shooter, but I know that I can make an impact and help us win and give us the best chance to be successful out on the court. So I think that really the biggest thing, just trusting yourself, because like I said, everyone works hard. There's not a doubt in my mind that everyone in college, NBA, overseas, whatever the case may be, is always working hard. But I think the biggest thing for me and in life, you just never know when that opportunity is going to come. Timing and opportunity, I think, is just such a huge thing. And it's probably a huge reason for why I am where I am today, because you never want anyone to get hurt. You never want anyone to get injured or whatever the case may be, but you need to be prepared for when that happens to be able to take advantage of it. Because like I said, it might only be that one chance that you get and be like, you know what? I'm thinking he's a two-way player. Can he play in the NBA? Oh, he played 4 or 5 games at 38 minutes and averaged like 14-6. Yeah, he can play. Yeah, like it's so quick where they're like, you know what? Like he can play. If you're that borderline guy, I could give you that couple games, that one game, that 5-game span, a week, 2-week span, your 10-day contracts. It might be that that might be the only chance you get to be like, oh, he did okay. But like, I think he's more suited for overseas, you know? You just got to be ready. And it's not all about making shots. Like, are you creating good shots for your team? Are you doing the little things to be able to help your team be successful? And that's one thing with me that besides the working hard, I try to bring a positive energy and a positive mindset to our team every single day here too. I like to be upbeat. I like to go after guys and like talk smack to them because I know that like if I make Zach LaVine better on a daily basis and that might be me just nudging him and stuff, even if I don't play and he plays well, I'm going to feel like I'm contributing to the team. So I always do it to him. I do it to everyone on my team. And I talk my smack and I get in their face a little bit just to be able to push them because I want them to be successful and I want us to be good. So it's not always about your individual statistics rather than the team outcome and team result.
Right. I like that. And that's something that we spoke about. We had a player when I was with the Suns, Alan Williams. Mm-hmm. So he came in from China. Came from China, and he came in at the very end of the season. So he finishes the year, and we're going into the next year. And I remember sitting in a room, and Coach Earl Watson, he's sitting there, and we was talking about who we're going to bring, who we're going to let go. And he said, we have to have Al. He said, we need Big Al because it's positivity, just because the way he cheers on the bench. Then we spent that whole entire summer. It was he and I and then Coach Watson and Nate Bjorkren, who was actually the head coach now with the Pacers.
Yeah.
We're there in the gym the whole summer, and we're working on Al's game, and then he plays well, and he signed that – it was not guaranteed,
deal, right?
That 3-year, $18 million.
Yeah.
So he went from – and it's just because of contribution from cheering at that moment to get his opportunity.
Absolutely.
Okay, so – we know you're going to go in there. We know you're going to work hard, right?
Yeah.
What are we going to see new this year?
Yeah. For me, honestly, I mean, to be able to be in the NBA now, like I said before, you got to be able to shoot the ball. Like if you can't shoot, you can't – like it's not like you can't play, but you got to be able to space the floor. Everything is about spacing right now in the NBA. And you got to be able to stretch the defense out to be able to create lanes for others to go make plays. But for me, I can't add everything to my game because I think my game is like solid in what it is. I just need to keep getting better at everything, like coming off ball screens, making simple reads and making plays. I got to be able to shoot the ball above 37-38%. And that's like an elite level. If you're only getting so many opportunities, if you're taking 2-3 a game, that you're not getting the starters minutes where they're able to take 6-8. So just being able to knock down shots in my opportunity. So I've just been working on shooting and making decisions off of ball screens and slowly getting my mid-range game back now too. So
okay. That's
kind of what I'm working on.
Okay. All right. Yeah. And don't forget, you got a Wildcat here in Phoenix who guys come out to all summer. So there's a stop out here in Phoenix.
But, oh, absolutely.
Other than that, one other thing, we spoke about a little bit earlier, Did you got? I know you got to see the BC game mm-hmm. and the ASU game, right? Yeah. I know we had the BC game. I spoke with this about someone else. You know, Boston College was driving to the lane pretty easy.
Yeah.
On certain points, you know, struggling. And I thought that was just, it's early in the season. Plus, yeah. I know our white defense should stop that.
Yeah.
You know, I wasn't too concerned about that. Mm-hmm. And then we had the ASU game, which I think they had a real strong showing.
Yeah.
Especially Jeremiah. I mean, yeah. he played. What are your thoughts on the team? What are your thoughts on their play so far? I know we had a tough loss to Virginia Tech, which I really yeah. loved. Just because of the amount of the games you played in short days. But what are your thoughts on the team so far?
Yeah, I think that, I mean, I think it's going to be tough. And it always takes Coach Wright teams some time to figure out how to play Villanova basketball. You know, I think they weren't as composed as what you normally are or like expecting of them. But it's early in the season. They've only had so many practices. They missed some time for some COVID stuff. And it's just such a different season than what the regular college basketball season. And there's going to be times like this where it's like, you know, we have to play 3 games in 4 nights or 4 games in 6 days, whatever the case may be. But you got to be ready. And I think that their toughness and stuff isn't lacking. So I know that's fine. You know, I think that like the little things in execution-wise, they can definitely do a little bit better. Continue to guard off the bounce. I think that's going to be a huge thing. I think you hit on that in the BC game and the Arizona State game. I mean, a long athletic team like that. We just need to continue to team rebound. I saw only saw like the box score in the overtime of the Virginia Tech game. We got out rebounded by 10 to 12. And I think that Jeremiah has been boarding the ball, but we need everyone to go down there and crash the glass and be able to make some quick outlets and go from there. But I'm excited about the team. I mean, I know they returned four starters. Incorporating Caleb in there as well is going to be big. You know, he's starting, but as a transfer, it's different playing for Coach Wright than his other guys. So you've seen it from the sidelines. But I think it'll still take time to get that continuity with the whole team and that chemistry because it's a whole new season. And like I said, only so many practices, only so many times they were able to be together. But I'm excited about the team. I think they're going to be really good. And I don't think anyone should be discouraged about a slow start versus BC, a tough game that they won against Arizona State, or even a loss against Virginia Tech. I think these are all growing moments. And usually you're able to play maybe a lower level D1 team first, kind of get your feet wet a little bit. But you open up, I don't care if they were projected last place, the ACC, 13th, whatever the case may be. You're still playing an ACC team with some big-time right. recruits and big-time players that, like, some guys haven't seen that before. You know, they've only seen the mid- to low-level guys. And early in the season, playing these big-time games is only going to help them later in the season, especially with the tougher Big East this year as well. So I'm encouraged about them.
Thanks. Thanks for giving that insight. You know, I think it's always important to see how people see, you know, the progress of the team and mm-hmm. the challenges. I myself personally, I'm encouraged. You know, I think they're playing strong. Another thing to could always consider, one thing about Villanova it's that stands out and how we are always able to overcome is our level of preparation. Hmm. And with the Virginia Tech game, if I'm not mistaken, that game was a filling for something else that was canceled.
Yeah.
So we didn't have that normal preparation that we normally would have. So that then you get into like the NCAA tournament.
Yeah.
You know, it's like it was a little March Madness there.
Coach Wright is so, I mean, we all, I mean, us players know this, is so like driven by like, and so planned out. Every little thing is planned out on the clock and throughout the day. And we eat 4 hours before we take, like, we get our minds mentally right. We have our walkthrough, we have our shoot around, like, so I think that he's probably adjusting to all this stuff too. And it's not something that he's familiar with the crazy chaotic of the COVID stuff of
right.
maybe stuff is just different in the hotel. And I'm not saying that's the reason why you lose. You lose because the other team had more points,
right.
But we're so consistent. We're a consistent program and just trying to be able to figure that out in a time where there's no consistency and no fluidity.
Right.
Fluid that I think that could make a difference well. So I think it's exactly what you're saying about not having that same preparation. It's like, oh, we're playing St. Joe's on Tuesday, but nope, now we're playing Hartford and you have one day to prepare.
Right.
You know, it's
right.
like we haven't seen Hartford play in 4 years. We haven't played them since 2010, whatever the case may be. You just don't know the same stuff. And it's the same for both teams though. So it's like
right.
what coaches are going to be staying up late, watching their films and getting the right, scouting report down, and then how ready are the players to play their third game in 4 nights? It's like they're playing NBA schedules now.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah. But there sure are challenges, but I remain excited. I remain, encouraged by what I see, because I really like what I see from the team. I really do. I really, really do. Especially being this early in the year, and knowing, again, to your point, people don't really realize how much growth occurs in the season almost every year playing Villanova basketball. So if they look like this now, I can't imagine what they're going to look like in a month from now.
No, yeah. As former players, we all know that it's going to take some time, and there might be some bumps in the road on the way. But at the end of the season, Coach Wright's going to have them playing good basketball and some winning basketball. So it's definitely encouraging.
Yeah. So, Arch, again, thank you for joining us here at Blue Blood on the Main Line.
Appreciate you.
I want everyone who hears the sound of my voice to watch the Bulls. Share my guy Arch on. All right, share him on. Log in, streamline. Click, turn to that channel when the Bulls playing. Also, you come out here to Phoenix, you come to town, if time permits, because I know how the schedules are, where sometimes you're leaving at night or something, or if you get later on that day.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll be sure to hit you up, no doubt.
Yeah, we'll link up. We'll link up for sure. There's one way we always end this show. Two things. Number one, I want to tell everybody, subscribe, leave a review, let me know what you think about this conversation that we have with Arch, with our Villanova legend. Also, Arch, every guy, you know how we end it, once a Wildcat,
always a Wildcat. I like it. All right, Jay Frey, thank you for having me.
Take care.
See ya.
Love.